Hello. This is the third in my series of lectures on ideological critique. Last week, you will recall, I gave a shout out to a former student, Jennifer Jensen Wallach, who wrote her doctoral dissertation with me in the 1990s. I invited her to join me in my imagination in this classroom so that I would think of myself as speaking to former students rather than just to a camcorder set up across the way on my desk. This week, I will reach way back in my experience as a teacher, almost to the very beginning of my long career, to invite another student to join Jennifer in this lecture. The student is Thomas Cathcart. In 1958, after I had gotten my doctorate and had completed the active duty part of my military service, I was appointed to an instructorship in philosophy and general education at Harvard. My duties in the philosophy department were, for the most part, to teach all of the sophomore and junior tutorial. And I had a number of groups of sophomores and another number of groups of juniors. In 1959-60, I had three groups of juniors, and in one of them, Tom Cathcart stood out. Tom was a tall, lanky, red-haired young man, very bright, who stuck in my memory. And although I lost touch with him after he graduated the next year, many years later, we reconnected. Tom didn't go into philosophy, but late in his life, after he'd retired from his actual career, he went back to philosophy and published a marvelous little book, which was a collection of philosophical jokes organized like a textbook. Jokes on epistemology, jokes on metaphysics, jokes on philosophy of religion, jokes on ethics, and so forth. It was a big hit. It was called Plato and Platypus Walk into a Bar, and you may have encountered it. In fact, it was so successful that he and another student, Dan Klein, brought out a second volume, which was called, Here it is. Heidegger and a Hippo Walk Through the Pearly Gates. You might be interested to know what I assigned to the students in those days. This was way back when, and I had them read A.J. Ayer's Language, Truth, and Logic. They read J.L. Austin's essay, Other Minds, and they also read a book by a former professor of mine, Clarence Irving Lewis, Mind and the World Order, which I thought then, and I still think now, was one of the best pieces of philosophy ever written by an American, although it has all but vanished from view. How did Tom do as a student? Well, I have records on every student who has ever studied with me, going all the way back to 1955, when I was a teaching fellow in the philosophy department at Harvard. And here are my records of my tutorial groups. I find that Tom, on his final paper, let's see just exactly how he did, a quite coherent and interesting paper on aesthetics and the given, I say. A. That was the only A in that tutorial group. This was before grade inflation, and an A was a very strong grade. Another student, I notice, got a B+ with a solid but obscure job on the given and experience. That was a young man who was so forgettable that I forgot that he was my student for many, many years. His name was David Souter, and it seems to me that he made something of himself. Ah, yes, he became an Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court. Still rather forgettable, but not a bad show for a B+ student. Well, Tom, if you will take your seat in my imaginary classroom next to Jennifer, I can return to Mannheim and wrap up this part of this series of lectures. Let me remind you, just as a brief review, that I identified three criteria of fully ideological beliefs. First of all, they must serve to rationalize the interests of some social, economic, or other class, and either make it appear that no change in the dominance of those interests is possible, that's an ideology, or make it appear that these interests will soon become dominant in the society. Mannheim calls that a utopia. Second, they must be false, distortions of reality. And finally, and rather controversially, I said that their falsity must be so manifest that only interest-bound self-deception can explain why they are believed. Someone made a comment on my blog about this third criterion, raising the question whether perhaps there weren't actually these days a great many people who self-consciously served the interests of the ruling class. And of course that is true. But what Mannheim pointed out, and it is striking, is how often one finds intelligent, thoughtful, knowledgeable people who say things that are simply manifestly false and which serve the interests of the ruling class. I have in mind all of modern economic theory, but that's another matter for another series of lectures. Mannheim then went on to distinguish between particular self-deceptive distortions and general systematic self-deceptions or worldviews, Weltanschauungen, as he called them in German. And these systematic worldviews oppose one another in such totalizing fashion that it's impossible for individuals to get a handle on anything but their own worldview. There doesn't seem to be any place to stand where you can view them from an objective perspective and judge their relative merits and demerits. This troubled Mannheim enormously, and so you'll recall I pointed out that Mannheim actually offered a solution, an implausible solution, but a solution nonetheless, namely that the intellectuals, the intelligentsia, the free-floating intellectuals, as he called them, would somehow be unattached to any social class or economic class and therefore be able to arrive at an objective, knowledge-based, rational evaluation of the competing worldviews. That was, I thought, and still think, a completely delusional view on Mannheim's part, but it's quite understandable that he should think it because he was so distressed by what seemed to him to be the loss of rationality in the modern world. That's as much as we need in order for me to move on to the other parts of these lectures. We will use these concepts as we move forward, talking about the Kalahari, talking about African American literature, and then finally, as a kind of amusing coda, talking about Jane Austen's novel Mansfield Park. But before I leave Mannheim, there is something else I want to tell you about. Because in Ideology and Utopia, in chapter 4, Mannheim does something that I think is one of the most brilliant tour de force I have ever encountered in an intellectual work of this sort. He presents us with an ideology of time consciousness itself, which is an astonishing idea. This is going to take a good deal of explanation. As a lead-in, consider this following this provocative passage from chapter 2. If you're following along with me, you'll find it on page 82. Mannheim says, "Today we have arrived at the point where we can see clearly that there are differences in modes of thought, not only in different historical periods, but also in different cultures. Slowly it dawns upon us that not only does the content of thought change, but also its categorical structure. Only very recently has it become possible to investigate the hypothesis that in the past, as well as in the present, the dominant modes of thought are supplanted by new categories when the social basis of the group of which these thought forces are characteristic disintegrates or is transformed under the impact of social change." The phrase that caught me in that paragraph was the phrase, "its categorical structure." Let me explain. I started life as a Kant scholar, and to a Kant scholar, the phrase categorical structure has a quite specific meaning. It refers to Kant's theory in the Critique of Pure Reason that the mind imposes categories upon its experience, categories like cause and effect, substance, and so forth. I might say as a kind of sidebar that when I wrote my doctoral dissertation and my first book, Kant's Theory of Mental Activity, I wrote them in longhand. I literally wrote them on a pad in longhand. And my mother, who was a spectacular typist and proofreader, would type them up for me. Every time she came to a phrase like categorical structure, she would automatically change it to categorical, which is, of course, what you would think it ought to be. And then I would have to call her up on the telephone and say, "No, Mom, I really meant categorical. Could you please change it to categorical?" When I read that, I thought to myself, can Mannheim literally be claiming that Kant's categories, his forms of intuition and thought, are themselves socially based and interest determined? That's an astonishing claim. I need to say a word about Kant and German intellectuals to make it clear to you why this was so important. To an intellectual, a German-speaking intellectual of Mannheim's generation, and indeed subsequent generations, the main man, the big cheese, is Immanuel Kant. Bigger than Hegel, bigger than Plato, bigger than Aristotle. For the French, it's Descartes, but for the Germans, it was Kant. In Ideology and Utopia, Mannheim actually undertakes an ideological analysis of time consciousness itself. Just a word to indicate how important Kant was to German intellectuals. Back in the late 60s, when I was teaching at Columbia, I gave a talk one day to a faculty seminar, which invited not only members of the Columbia faculty, but intellectuals in the New York area in general. I gave a talk on Mill's On Liberty, and I was very critical from a left perspective. I gave old John Stuart pretty hard going for an hour. After the lecture was over, Hannah Arendt came up to visit and say hello. And it was obvious from her comments that even though she was trying to be polite, she didn't think much of the talk. But she was polite, so she said to me, "And what are you working on now?" And I said, "I'm writing a book on Kant's ethics." Suddenly she was transformed. She burst into an enormous smile and she said, "Ah, it is so much more pleasant to spend time with Kant." I encountered the same attitude when I first met Herbert Marcuse, who was then teaching at Brandeis, and I was still a young instructor at Harvard. I was a young whippersnapper, and I had been brought up in analytic philosophy, for which Marcuse had no patience whatsoever. But when he learned that I was a Kant scholar, that I was actually writing a book on the Critique of Pure Reason, he decided I couldn't be all bad, and on that basis we became fast friends. Well, let me say just a word about the role of space and time in Kant's philosophy so that you understand why Mannheim's effort is so extraordinary. This is not going to be a lecture on Kant. That's a subject for an entirely different series of lectures and a very much longer series, I'm afraid. Suffice it to say that according to Kant, the mind brings to experience forms that lie ready in the mind, which the mind imposes upon its experience. There are two sorts of forms, those of sensibility or perception, and those of conception. The forms of sensibility, Kant says, are space and time, so that the mind actually contributes the spatial and temporal structure of its experience to that experience. When he first announced this view in 1770, in the lecture that he gave when he was raised to a professorship at the University of Königsberg, all his emphasis was on space, because Kant thought that by this doctrine he could explain the otherwise inexplicable fact that Euclidean geometry was a collection of propositions that were not logical tautologies or truths, but which nevertheless we could know the truth of a priori. And we could know the truth of them a priori because the formal structure of space, which Euclidean geometry articulates, is contributed by the mind itself to experience. 11 years later, when Kant published the Critique of Pure Reason and announced to the world this revolution in philosophy, the emphasis had all shifted away from space to time. And it was time in the Critique of Pure Reason that was the universal form of all experience, and which underlay, in ways which I won't trouble you with, our knowledge of the causal law and all of our knowledge of physics. So for Mannheim to suggest that time itself is ideologically encoded is an extraordinary break with the Kantian tradition in which he and all other German intellectuals were raised. Mannheim actually identifies four modes of orientation to time, all of which he calls utopian orientations to time. And these are the orgiastic chiliasm of the Anabaptists, how's that for a phrase, the liberal humanitarian idea, the conservative idea, and the socialist communist utopia. Speaking generally about all four utopian ideas, Mannheim explains the relation in time to time consciousness. Let me say, by the way, for those of you who don't know the word chiliasm, chiliasm or chiliastic comes from the Greek. It's the same word coming from the Greek that millennial is coming from the Latin. I'll get to chiliasm in just a moment, but first let me read what he says on page 209. He's talking now about all of these forms. He says, "It is the utopian element, i.e. the nature of the dominant wish, which determines the sequence, order, and evaluation of single experiences. This wish is the organizing principle which even molds the way in which we experience time." It even molds the way in which we experience time itself. "The form in which events are ordered and the unconsciously emphatic rhythm which the individual in his spontaneous observation of events imposes upon the flux of time appears in the utopia as an immediately perceptible picture, or at least as a directly intelligible set of meanings. The innermost structure of the mentality of a group can never be as clearly grasped as when we attempt to understand its conception of time in the light of its hopes, yearnings, and purposes. On the basis of these purposes and expectations, a given mentality orders not merely future events, but also the past. Events which at first glance present themselves as a mere chronological accumulation, from this point of view, take on the character of destiny. Bare facts set themselves in perspective, and emphasis and meaning are distributed and apportioned to individual happenings in accordance with the fundamental directions in which the personality strives. It is in nothing but this meaningful ordering of events, extended far beyond mere chronological orderings, that the structural principle of historical time is to be discovered. But it is necessary to go even further. This ordering of meaning is, in fact, the most primary element in the comprehension and interpretation of events." Now, for Kant, it was taken for granted without debate that the mind, i.e. all human minds, impose the same spatio-temporal order on experience, so that the same physics, the same geometry, is true for all human experience. It never dawned on Kant even to question the possibility that our experience, that our imposition of spatial and temporal forms themselves might be encoded by, shaped by our interests, our economic interests, our religious interests, our political interests. To Kant, that would have seemed grotesque and absurd. That's what Mannheim is asserting. That's an extraordinary claim. Let me turn now to each of the four utopian moments that he identifies. First, the orgiastic chiliasm of the Anabaptists. The Anabaptists were a 17th century Christian sect, a Protestant sect, that believed that Jesus would come a second time, the so-called second coming, and that when he came, he would rule the earth for 1,000 years, hence chiliasm or millennial. He would rule the earth for 1,000 years, at the end of which there would be a violent battle between the forces of heaven and the forces of Satan. The forces of Satan would be defeated, time would come to an end, those who were blessed would go to heaven, those who were damned would go to hell, and the universe would end. All of you, I'm sure, are familiar with this general conception from the modern end times theology and the theory of the rapture. The rapture, you may know or may not know, is that event that devout Christians, especially in the United States, are waiting for day by day, at which point those who are saved will be taken bodily to heaven, minus their dental fillings and their hip replacements, by the way, and everyone else will be left wandering around on earth bereft. This goes along with the end times theology, which says that at any moment the end of time will come with the second coming of Jesus and the final Armageddon, the final battle between the forces of good and evil. That's the view which was held by the orgiastic, by the chiliastics, by the Anabaptists. Here is what Mannheim has to say about them. He says, the only true, perhaps the only direct identifying characteristic of chiliastic experience is absolute presentness. We always occupy some here and now on the spatial and temporal stage, but from the point of view of chiliastic experience, the position that we occupy is only incidental. For the real chiliast, the present becomes the breach through which what was previously inward bursts out suddenly, takes hold of the outer world, and transforms it. And he goes on, the chiliast expects a union with the immediate present. Hence, he is not preoccupied in his daily life with optimistic hopes for the future or romantic reminiscences. His attitude is characterized by a tense expectation. He is always on his toes, awaiting the propitious moment, and thus there is no inner articulation of time for him. He is not actually concerned with the millennium that is to come. What is important for him is that it happened here and now, and that it arose from mundane experience as a sudden swing over into another kind of existence. The promise of the future which is to come is not for him a reason for postponement, but merely a point of orientation, something external to the ordinary course of events from which he is on the lookout, ready to take the leap. So for the chiliast, the ordinary flow of time is as nothing. It is unimportant. It's just filler. He's waiting for the moment, which will be a precise moment when the infinite bursts into the finite and Jesus returns, the end of time comes, and he is fulfilled. So, does he buy life insurance? Well, maybe, maybe not, but it doesn't matter. Does he have a pension plan? It couldn't matter to him less. Does he have a regular job? Does he worry about his grandchildren? Does he think about his grandparents? No, everything is focused on the moment when Jesus will come again and the infinite will erupt into the finite. By the way, some of you may be familiar with the philosophy of Søren Kierkegaard, and you may see very interesting similarities here, and they are real, as between Kierkegaard on the one hand and these chiliastic Anabaptists on the other. This orientation toward time makes the whole timeline of no importance except for one moment, and that moment is the focus of all of his emotional energies. He doesn't think about what it will be like afterward. It isn't that he is yearning for heaven, he is yearning for the moment. And what is important to him is only that that moment should come in his own lifetime. And that's his entire focus is on that. Completely contrasted with this conception is the liberal humanitarian idea, so-called. The second utopian moment, which is completely different from the chiliastic orientation toward time. The liberal humanitarian experiences time as a steady, unilinear, upward trend toward a better, more rational social and economic order. For the liberal humanitarian, time is a line, but it's not a flat line. It's a line that rises from the past to the future, which means that what is future is always going to be better than what was past. This is the optimistic, unilinear, liberal view. It's not a matter of stops and starts and reversals. It's not two steps back, one step forward, three steps forward, two steps back. It's a slow, steady, upward rise. This is associated, by the way, in historiography with the phrase the Whig interpretation of history, which was coined by Herbert Butterfield and which nicely characterizes this conception of time. Here is Wikipedia's useful summary of the notion. Whig history presents, this was a term, by the way, which was coined to describe 19th century English history, hence Whig. The view held by John Stuart Mill and by other 19th century liberals that things were improving steadily and slowly, that the future would be better than the past, that present problems would be resolved, the problems with early capitalism would be overcome, and the world would move slowly and steadily to a better and better place. We're familiar with this in our obsession with whether the gross national product is increasing, whether unemployment is decreasing, whether things are moving in the right direction. as they say when they take polls. Here's what Wikipedia has to say. Whig history presents the past as an inevitable progression towards ever greater liberty and enlightenment, culminating in modern forms of liberal democracy and constitutional monarchy. That is to say, 19th century England. In general, Whig historians emphasize the rise of constitutional government, pursued freedom, and scientific progress. Whig history is a form of liberalism, putting its faith in the power of human reason to reshape society for the better, regardless of past history and tradition. This is a completely different orientation of time. In the liberal humanitarian experience of time, what lies in the future is always better, always more evolved, always higher than what lies in the past. As Mannheim says, it is a manner of experiencing historical time as unilinear progress and evolution. Mannheim sees this orientation toward time as arising out of the emergence of capitalism, not surprisingly. And the crucial point here is, Mannheim is rejecting the view that this is the truth about the world. It is one ideological orientation toward time itself, which arises out of a certain economic and social base. I can't resist here turning to another author, another who is himself a very distinguished conservative, to read you some of his rather critical remarks about this notion, this form of liberalism. I'm talking about Michael Oakeshott. Some of you may be familiar with Oakeshott's name, some may not. Oakeshott was an English conservative thinker who is, I think, the most distinguished conservative thinker of the 20th century. His very best book is a collection of essays called Rationalism and Politics, and if I can't urge you strongly enough to take a look at it. The two essays in this book that you especially want to read are the title essay, Rationalism and Politics, and a second essay, Rational Conduct, which I think is philosophically deeper and more powerful, although not as amusing as the essay, Rationalism and Politics. Why am I a radical praising Oakeshott? Well, first of all, because I love brilliant work no matter who writes it. And secondly, because the critique of liberalism from the right and the critique of liberalism from the left frequently have much in common. And in this case, I find Oakeshott's critique of liberalism devastating, even though it comes from a different side of the political spectrum than my own. Let me read you just a bit about what he says in his essay, Rationalism and Politics. This is at the very beginning of the essay. He says about the liberal, he has no sense of the accumulation of experience, only of the readiness of experience when it has been converted into a formula. The past is significant to him only as an encumbrance. You see, because things are steadily getting better, the past is just something to be put behind. He has none of that negative capability which Keats attributed to Shakespeare, the power of accepting the mysteries and uncertainties of experience without any irritable search for order and distinctness, only the capability of subjugating experience. He has no aptitude for that close and detailed appreciation of what actually presents itself, which Lichtenberg called negative enthusiasm, but only the power of recognizing the large outline which a general theory imposes upon events. And then he goes on. The mind of the rationalist, which impresses us as at best a finely tempered neutral instrument, as a well-trained rather than an educated mind, intellectually his ambition is not so much to share the experience of the race as to be demonstrably a self-made man. And this gives to his intellectual and practical activities an almost preternatural deliberateness and self-consciousness, depriving them of any element of passivity, removing from them all sense of rhythm and continuity, and dissolving them into a succession of climacterics, each to be surmounted by a tour de raison. His mind has no atmosphere, no changes of season and temperature. His intellectual processes, so far as possible, are insulated from all external influence and go on in the void. He is, as it were, the hired expert. and having cut himself off from the traditional knowledge of his society and denied the value of any education more extensive than a training in a technique of analysis, he is apt to attribute to mankind a necessary inexperience in all the critical moments of life. And if he were more self-critical, he might begin to wonder how the race had ever succeeded in surviving. And then, one of the most beautiful lines in conservative thought. With an almost poetic fancy, he strives to live each day as if it were his first, and he believes that to form a habit is to fail. Let me read that again. That's a marvelously devastating description of the liberal. With an almost poetic fancy, he strives to live each day as if it were his first, and he believes that to form a habit is to fail. And if, with as yet no thought of analysis, we glance below the surface, we may perhaps see in the temperament, if not in the character of the rationalist, a deep distrust of time, an impatient hunger for eternity, and an irritable nervousness in the face of everything topical and transitory. That's Oakeshott talking about, essentially, the liberal orientation toward time, although he doesn't describe it that way. Finally, let me come back to Mannheim once more for a passage on the liberal. The liberal idea, says Mannheim, is adequately intelligible only as a counterpart to the ecstatic attitude of the Kiliast, which often hides behind a rationalist facade and which historically and socially offers a continual potential threat to liberalism. It is a battle cry against that stratum of society whose power comes from its inherited position in the existing order and which is able to master the here and now, at first unconsciously and later through rational calculation. Here we see how different utopias can shape the whole structure of consciousness itself and can reflect the divergence between two historical worlds and the two correspondingly fundamentally different social strata whose outlooks they embody. I'm reminded here of several things. One is the famous old story about the American, a liberal in temperament, who arrives in England and is invited to a historic country estate, looks out over the beautiful lawns, and asks the owner of the estate, who is the heir, the last in a long line of baronet, or the latest in the long line of baronets or whatever, how do you get such a beautiful lawn? And the baronet says quietly, you scatter some grass seed and roll it for 600 years. The other story that I love is about a young nouveau riche woman, young wife, trying to make it in old Boston society, invited to a tea party, and she's talking to several old grand dames of Beacon Hill, and she says, tell me, where do you get your hats? She wants to be outfitted in exactly the same way as these ladies. And one of them says, where do you buy your hats? She asks. And one of the ladies says, we don't buy our hats. We have our hats. That captures everything about the contrast between the liberal and the conservative. Now we come to the conservative idea. I should tell you, Mannheim was a scholar of conservatism. That was the focus of a good deal of his research. And he's marvelous on conservatism. Here is what he says about the conservative idea. This is contrasted, of course, with the liberal idea. He says, the time sense of this mode of experience, that is, the conservative, and thought is completely opposed to that of liberalism. Whereas, do you understand what's going on here? Let me just interrupt myself. I'm reading these passages to you, and I'm hoping that you are following along and understanding what they're saying. But what's going on here is that Mannheim is saying that the way in which people experience time itself is shaped by their Weltanschauung, by their worldview, by their interest-encoded perspective, whether it is liberal or conservative or Kiliastic, so that a liberal and a conservative looking at the same events cannot see them in the same way because the temporal structure of them appears different to the liberal and to the conservative. To the liberal, what is past is lesser and is to be surmounted by what is coming in the future. To the conservative, it's exactly the opposite. Mannheim goes on. Whereas for liberalism, the future was everything and the past nothing, the conservative mode of experiencing time found the best corroboration of its sense of determinateness in discovering the significance of the past, in the discovery of time, time itself, as the creator of value. Duration did not exist at all for the chiliastic mentality, and existed for liberalism only insofar as henceforth it gave birth to progress. But for conservatism, everything that exists has a positive and nominal value merely because it has come into existence slowly and gradually. Time itself is the creator of value. So the conservative, in a way which the liberal thinks is quixotic and quirky, cherishes the fact that in English law courts, men still and women still wear wigs, a harking back to a time 300 years earlier. The conservative likes the odd rules of the United States Senate, the quirky ways in which they do things. The conservative doesn't view those as obstacles to progress. The conservative views those as the sediment of long experience and long time, and therefore in themselves valuable. It is the notion that simply because something has existed for a long time, it has acquired value. This goes along, by the way, with what's frequently called the myth of the golden past, which is very ancient. The notion that at a past time, there was a golden time, Eden, and that since then things have gone downhill. The conservative doesn't think that things have gone downhill. He just thinks, or she thinks, that because things have been done a certain way for a long time, because they have existed for a long time, they have acquired value thereby. Now, part of this is rationalized by arguing that in ways that it is difficult to articulate, the long experience of human beings dealing with the human world has produced accretions of habit and expectation in our institutions and our practices, which we may not understand, but which we can be sure had some value because they have survived. One of the most famous articulations of this view, maybe the most famous, is to be found not in Mannheim, but in a book by Edmund Burke called The Reflections on the Revolution in France. Some of you, I'm sure, have heard of it. Some of you may even have read it. You will recognize this passage, I suspect, because it is a very, very famous passage. Burke is here talking. He is talking about the so-called social contract theory, the theory which was the darling of liberal political philosophers, that the legitimacy of the state derives from a prior social contract, an explicit agreement among all the people in the society that henceforth they will be governed in certain ways by certain rules. Some of you may be familiar with a modern, sophisticated version of this, the so-called original position theory of John Rawls. But this all goes back to the 17th and 18th centuries and the classical social contract theory of John Locke, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, and others. Here is what Burke has to say. Society is indeed a contract. Subordinate contracts for objects of mere occasional interest may be dissolved at pleasure. But the state ought not to be considered as nothing better than a partnership agreement in a trade of pepper and coffee, calico or tobacco, or some other such low concern, to be taken up for a little temporary interest and to be dissolved by the fancy of the parties. It is to be looked on with other reverence, because it is not a partnership in things subservient only to the gross animal existence of a temporary and perishable nature. It is a partnership in all science, a partnership in all art, a partnership in every virtue and in all perfection. As the ends of such a partnership cannot be obtained in many generations, it becomes a partnership not only between those who are living, but between those who are living, those who are dead, and those who are to be born. Each contract of each particular state is but a clause in the great primeval contract of eternal society, linking the lower with the higher natures, connecting the visible and invisible world according to a fixed compact sanctioned by the inviolable oath which holds all physical and all moral natures, each in their appointed place. This law is not subject to the will of those who, by an obligation above them and infinitely superior, are bound to submit their will to that law. And on he goes. The key passage is, and the most famous passage, it is a partnership not only between those who are living, but between those who are living, those who are dead, and those who are to be born. That is the classic conservative orientation toward time itself. Finally, we get to the socialist communist utopia, the fourth of the four orientations toward time. And here is what Mannheim has to say about it. He says, that's odd. I haven't marked the passages. That can't be right. I am brought to a halt in my exposition here by the fact that I seem not to have marked the passage I wanted to read. Here we go. Well, essentially what Mannheim is saying is that in the socialist communist utopia, time is seen as focused on a single moment, but not like the Kiliasts, a moment from which all else recedes as unimportant, but rather a moment which organizes all time before and after, and that moment is the revolution. Everything leading up to that moment is seen as preparing for the revolution. Everything after that moment is seen as bringing about a completely different order, so that there is a temporal break in the revolution between what went before and what went after. And that orientation toward time dominates the thinking, Mannheim thinks, of the revolutionaries, for whom the revolution is the moment when their long preparation will be fulfilled, after which all of society will be transformed. I'm reminded of the great biography of Joseph Stalin by Isaac Deutscher, in which Deutscher describes the Russian revolutionaries as working tirelessly in the shadows for the revolution, which finally comes in 1905. But it isn't the revolution they were working for. So instead of becoming discouraged, they go right back to working, not knowing when the revolution will come, until 12 years later they have their opportunity. And there is finally the Bolshevik Revolution, which brings into existence the Soviet Union. That orientation toward time is completely different from the Kiliastic, for whom everything that comes before and after is of no importance and only the erupting moment matters. Completely different from this slow, long, rising line of improvement, which is the liberal orientation toward time. Completely different from the conservative valuation of the past simply because it is past. It is a fourth and completely different orientation toward time itself. Well, this concludes everything that I think I need to talk about before moving on in my lectures on ideological critique. But instead of stopping there with Mannheim, I want to try something out. As a Kant scholar, when I read Mannheim, I was stunned by the notion that time itself was ideologically encoded. But as a Kant scholar also, I quite naturally thought, and what about space? Could there be an ideological analysis of space consciousness analogous to the ideological analysis of time consciousness that Mannheim had so brilliantly carried out? Well, Mannheim doesn't do it, so I thought I'd give it a try. Now, this is in the form, in the manner of a jeu d'esprit. I don't for a moment imagine that I can match the historical depth and complexity and power of Mannheim's analysis, but I thought it was worth a try. So I sat down and I asked myself, are there orientations towards space which are ideologically encoded in some way analogous to the way that Mannheim has shown us orientations toward time are ideologically encoded? And I came up with four ideological orientations towards space, four moments of space consciousness. They don't exactly match the four moments of ideological time consciousness, but here they are. I identified the nationalist moment, the imperialist moment, the world federalist moment, and the revolutionary moment. So if you will forgive me, I'm now going to spend a little time giving you not Mannheim's views, which are well worth attending to, but my views, which you can take or leave alone as you wish. Let me start with the notion of anisotropy. That may be a word you're not familiar with. Isotropy, or isotropic, simply means same space. Isotropy in physics means that all regions of space are identical and interchangeable. It's the notion that underlies Newtonian physics. In Newtonian physics, the laws of physics obtain in exactly the same way in every region of space. And for this reason, when you are constructing a three-dimensional set of axes, the x-axis, the y-axis, and the z-axis, so that you can locate objects in that structure and calculate the distances between them and so forth and so on, it's a matter of pure arbitrary choice where you locate the origin, the point where the three axes intersect. Since every point in space is the same as every other point in space, and since space is itself infinite, you can locate the origin of the axes anywhere. This is quite in contrast with the Aristotelian view, which is that the Earth is the center of space. Okay. For Newtonian physics, space is isotropic. But for the nationalist, the imperialist, the world federalist, and the revolutionary, space is anisotropic. Certain spaces have a different significance, importance, value than other spaces. Let's start with the nationalist ideology of space consciousness. The center of the nationalist conception of space is, of course, the nation, the homeland, the patria. And this space has a different valence or importance from every other space in the world. The central defining structure of the space is, of course, the border, which surrounds the space. Everything inside that border is more valuable, more important than everything outside that border. When you are inside that border, you are at home. You are in your country, you are in your nation. When you are outside, you are away. You are away from home. And that is true no matter how close the space outside the border may be to the space inside the border. If you live in Maine or Minnesota or Oregon, you're very close to Canada. And if you're wandering around in the woods, you may actually stumble across from the United States into Canada without even realizing that you have moved from one country to another. But the moment you become aware that you are now in Canada, you are, as a true nationalist, aware that you are away from home. And you may rush back to get inside the United States, or at least feel yourself somewhat disoriented or displaced, so long as you are away from home. When you travel, you may enjoy traveling, going to Europe, to Africa, to Australia, wherever, to South America. But always when you come back, that moment when you land in the airport and when you are passing through customs and you are now passing into the United States, there may be a sign that says you are now entering the United States. And you have a sense, I have come home. I am now at home. And there's a sense, the true nationalist, now I can relax. Now, of course, it may be that things were more comfortable where you were traveling than they are where you're coming home to. It may be that you were having a luxury tour and living the high life abroad whereas at home your life may not be nearly so luxurious. That has nothing to do with it. What's important is simply that now you are at home. And there's an absolute divide between what is inside and what is outside the border. Let me give you a personal example. My wife and I have a little apartment in Paris. It's not much bigger than my study here, but it is in Paris. It's on the left bank. We were in that apartment when the terrorist attacks took place in Paris some little while ago. We didn't know anything about them because we had gone to bed, but we discovered the next morning that they had taken place, and they'd taken place on the right bank, we're on the left bank, only about 2 miles from where we live. That was all. We came home, and some while later, the terrorist attacks took place in San Bernardino, California. San Bernardino is 3,000 miles from where we live in North Carolina. It's 3,000 miles away, and yet I had a sense of these things happening at home, because it was within the United States. And when they happened in Paris, I didn't have a sense of them as happening at home. I had a sense of them as happening in a foreign country, away. So it wasn't the physical distance between the two events. In one case, 2 miles, in the other case, 3,000 miles. It was that in one case, we were not at home, and in the other case, we were at home. There is enormous emotional attachment to this notion of the border and the homeland. There are also variations, of course. For example, the Germans sense that they had been denied some of their natural territory in Central Europe, so that the Nazis thought of themselves as recapturing their normal or natural space, their living room, their Lebensraum, when they expanded into Eastern Europe from the German borders. You also have the experience of countries like Korea and Germany before it was reunited, where a country is divided in half and people on both sides have a sense that the patria, the homeland, has been divided and needs to be reunited. This is the nationalist conception of space, and what it does is to divide all of space into two regions with absolutely different importance and valence: the region within the border and the region everything else, which is beyond, foreign. A variation on this which is significantly different is the imperialist ideology of space consciousness. In the imperialist conception of space, there is the homeland, the center of the empire, London, Great Britain, England, or Paris, France, and then there is the empire. Beyond the empire, there is everything else, so that there are really three spaces, and these three spaces have a certain natural hierarchy of importance and encoding. There is the center of the empire, the colonies, the extended empire, and then there is everything else. There are basically two fundamentally different conceptions of empire, which we have seen in the world. The British, French, or Dutch empires contrasted, let us say, with the Chinese, Russian, and American empires, which is to say the distinction between contiguous and non-contiguous spaces. In the British, French, or Dutch empires, there is the homeland, and then overseas or in foreign areas, there are the colonies. So the British colonies of Canada, the American colonies, British East Africa, India, and so forth, those are all non-contiguous. The Chinese, Russian, and American empires are different. The Chinese have a very powerful contiguous and centripetal sense of the Chinese empire. They think of themselves as the center of the universe, the center of the world. And then there are the areas around the edges, contiguous with, but around the edges of China. And when the central government is powerful, they absorb these into themselves so that Mongolia and Manchuria and Tibet and Southeast Asia become part of the empire. And when the central government is weak, then foreign forces recapture those areas, and the center of the empire shrinks. The same thing is true of Russia. When Russia becomes powerful, it expands into East Asia, Southeast Asia, Southern Europe, South and Eastern Europe. So you get the Soviet Socialist Republic as Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Kyrgyzia, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Belarus, the Crimea. You get Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and so forth. And then when the empire becomes weak, it loses control of those territories. And when now what Putin is trying to do is to reassert control over several of them as a way of trying to recapture part of its empire, but always contiguous. The Russians, it's interesting, since the Second World War, have almost never sent their troops beyond areas which were contiguous to the heartland. The American empire is very much like that. I mean, leaving aside the Philippines and Guam and so forth, which look more like an English conception of empire, but the central notion of empire in America has, of course, been the conquest of and the absorption of the entire continent. This is the notion, the Frederick Jackson Turner notion of the expansion into the West, the conquest of the West, which extends all the way to the Pacific Ocean and even absorbed Texas. Just to give you some idea of the way in which this notion of empire works in non-contiguous empires, I'll tell you about a personal experience I had early in my career. I taught at the University of Chicago from 1961 to 1963. And there I met a very famous political scientist named Grant McConnell, who had spent time at Makerere College in Kampala, Uganda. And he invited me to spend a year at Makerere teaching political theory. Makerere was part of what used to be British East Africa. And at Makerere College was an external college of the University of London. So I asked McConnell, well, if I'm going to teach political theory in Africa, what books am I going to teach? And he said, oh, you know, you'll teach Locke's Second Treatise, Hobbes's Leviathan, Rousseau's Social Contract, you'll teach Mill, you'll teach Kant. And I said, but, I'm going to teach those to a group of African students who've never been anywhere near Europe? And he said, yes, that's the curriculum of the University of London. In fact, he said, it's not only the curriculum of the University of London, but at the end of the year, the final examinations which the students must take are identically the same final examinations that are given at the University of London. They are the same examinations that are given at every external college everywhere in the world, even in India and in Canada. And in order, he said, to make sure that there's no cheating, the exam is given at the same time, so that in India the students might be taking the examination at 2 a.m., because that's the time when it was being given in London. Well, I thought that was reasonably bizarre, but since I had just gotten married, I decided that I didn't want to start my married life in Uganda, so I didn't go. It's too bad. I think it might have been a lot of fun. But that gives you some idea of the nature of imperial thinking. The interesting thing about the imperial orientation toward space is that it carries over even into the imperialist orientation toward the laws of physics, toward causal laws themselves. What do I mean by that? It is literally the case that the way in which imperialists think about the world, the way in which they represent it in their literature, for example, represents different parts of the world as controlled in different ways by the laws of physics, depending on how far they are from the center of the empire. Let me give you one of my favorite examples, which is these movies of voyages of exploration to Africa. I have in mind that great old movie, King Solomon's Mines, but a more modern example would be the movie that was made about the search of Richard Burton and John Speke for the headquarters of the Nile, for the headwaters of the Nile. Just a word of explanation. If you think about the Nile for a minute, the river that runs through Egypt from south to north, all the way to Cairo, and then and then empties into the Mediterranean. It will occur to you, if you think about it for a bit, that there are no tributaries leading into the Nile. The Nile is 4,000 miles long, and it runs year-round. Water pours down the Nile and into the Mediterranean, and it isn't fed by streams, it isn't fed by rivers, it isn't fed by melting ice. The water just keeps coming. And for millennia, this has been a source of mystery and of religious veneration for not only Egyptians, but for explorers of all sorts. In the 19th century, one of the high points of exploration was the effort to find the headwaters of the Nile. Where does the Nile come from? So off went Burton and Speke, and they actually found it. They found it in what they called Lake Victoria. But represented in movies, it always goes like this. I want you to think about this. All of you have seen these movies, I'm sure. It usually starts off in a very safe, comfortable place. Oxford, Cambridge, London, the Royal Society, the Society of Explorers, and somebody gets up and says that he's going to make an expedition to darkest Africa. It's not actually dark in Africa, by the way. It's quite sunny, but they think of it as darkest Africa. To find King Solomon's mines, to find the headquarters, the headwaters of the Nile, etc., etc. So off they go. First, what they do if they're in London is they take a hansom cab, very comfortable, very safe, to a train station. Then they get in a nice, comfy train compartment and they travel to Southampton. They get on a boat and they go on a long boat voyage. A little bit more difficult, but still comfortable, served by servants, comfortable quarters. They get to East Africa, and now things get a little bit more difficult. Fortunately, it's a jumble. People are speaking foreign languages. It's a turmoil in the marketplace. Fortunately, there is an Arab middleman who speaks English as well as the local languages, and he arranges for bearers who will carry all of the stuff that these explorers need in order to travel into the interior, as they call it. And off they go. First, they ride in wagons drawn by oxen. Then they give up the oxen when they get to rocky places where the wagons can't go. The bearers put these 50-pound, 60-pound packs on their backs, and they trudge along. Until one night, something scary happens, and when the Englishmen wake up, they discover that the bearers have run away. And now they're down to a few faithful retainers, and they have to carry their own stuff. So off they go, and it gets harder and harder and harder. It's physically harder. The laws of physics are changing. It's no longer easy to move around until finally, half dead, bitten by flies, attacked by wild animals, they stumble to the shores of Lake Victoria, which they name Lake Victoria, and which they think of as the first. They are the first men to see the headwaters of the Nile. Except, of course, there's a whole lot of people living there. There are people who've been living there for 50 or 60,000 years. They don't find it hard to get around. They were born there, they grew up there, they got married there, they had children there, they die there, they live there. For them, this is home. But it's not experienced as anything home-like by the English. The English think of it as terribly difficult to get around. And in one of the great, marvelous ideological distortions of reality, so do their bearers, even though their bearers live there as well. Even their bearers find it difficult to get around in the area that the English found it hard, difficult to get around in, even though these are locals who have lived there. So they find the headwaters of the Nile, and now they set out to come home. And sometimes they take back with them one of the natives, so-called. This native starts the trip, of course, in his neighborhood. I mean, this is his world. This is where he grew up. But he finds it just as hard as the English do. And it gets easier and easier and easier for the English as they get back to Nairobi, then they get on a boat, they get to England, they take a hansom cab, they get back to London. But it is also experienced as easier by the African who has come with them. Because in the imperialist orientation towards space, the laws of nature are ideologically encoded, not just for them, but for everybody. Now, there's a marvelous counterview to this, which I have to mention. A movie which you may or may not have seen called Greystoke, which is a modern remaking of the Tarzan story by Edgar Rice Burroughs. And in Greystoke, played, by the way, by Christopher Lambert, he plays Tarzan of the Apes beautifully. In Greystoke, Tarzan is at home in Africa when he is brought back to England, where he meets his grandfather, the great Sir Ralph Richardson, in the last movie that he ever made. He finds England completely incomprehensible and unmanageable. And when he finally goes back to Africa, he strips off his clothes and he swings through the trees into the forest, and he is again at home where it is easy for him. This is the only representation I've ever seen in popular culture that captures the reality that those who grow up and live in a place find it a natural and home-like and neighborhood-style place to live. They don't experience it as their imperialist masters experience it. Anyway, so much for the imperialist view of the world. Next, the world federalist ideology of space consciousness. By this I mean, world federalism was a movement which grew out of the Second World War. It was essentially a United Nations style movement. It's pretty much what the name suggests. That is to say, it was the view that the whole world was one place, that national borders made no difference. Imperial structures had been destroyed by the Second World War. There were no empires, and there should be a single world government of nations that would have plenary power and would rule all of mankind. It is what is represented in Star Trek as the United Federation of Planets. And it is the ideal of early post-World War II progressive thought, that there should be a world federation, no more nations, no more nation state. If you can view it as kind of the unintentional ideological representation of international capitalism, for which borders make no economic difference whatsoever. Finally, I said to myself, there has to be a revolutionary ideology of space consciousness. What can it possibly be? Well, I puzzled about this. There isn't any privileged two-dimensional space that corresponds to the revolutionary orientation towards space. Not world federalism, certainly not nationalism, not imperialism. What is it? And then it occurred to me, it isn't a space, it's a one-dimensional line. For the revolutionary, the focus of the revolutionary's orientation toward the world is a line. What is the line? The barricade. The barricade is the focus of the revolutionary's orientation toward space. And what defines the barricade is that there is the side you're on, and there's the other side that the enemy is on, and you are confronting your enemy. Anyone on your side is your comrade. Anyone on the other side, no matter what nation that person comes from, no matter what gender, no matter what race, no matter what economic or class the person comes from, if the person is on your side of the barricade, that person is your comrade. And if a person is on the other side of the barricade, that person is your enemy. And it's that distinction which defines the revolutionary orientation towards space. Let me conclude by telling you a story. Another story, this one, again, about a former student. In the 60s, when I was teaching at Columbia, I was giving lectures on ethical theory. And I was, at that time, working very hard on Kant's ethical theory, trying to find an argument in the groundwork of the metaphysics of morals that would justify Kant's claim that there is a single universal moral law which is binding on all moral agents as such, and which can be known by pure reason alone. And I wasn't having much success in finding that argument. So I would give lectures on Kant's ethics in which I would lay the problem out. I would canvass all of Kant's possible solutions. I would show what was wrong with them. And then I would say with a manifest air of distress, I'm sorry, but I can't find that argument in Kant. One day after class, a student in the class stopped me in the hall. I knew the student. He was a very radical student. He'd played a role in the occupation of the buildings in 1968. He was active working with local unions. And he said to me, "Why is it so important to you to find an argument for a universal moral law?" And I said, "Well, if I can't find that argument, then I won't know what to do. I won't know what it is right to do." And he looked at me, sort of the way a parent looks at a fondly loved but not very bright child. And he said to me quietly, "First you have to decide which side you are on. Then you'll know what to do."
Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? They say in Harlan County there are no neutrals there. You'll either be a union man or a thug for J.H. Blair. Which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? Tell me, which side are you on, boys? Which side are you on? My daddy was a miner, and I'm a miner's son. He'll be with you, fellow workers, until this battle's won. Tell me, which side are you on? Be a man. Which side are you on? Which side are you on? Tell me, which side are you on? Which side are you on? Come all of you good workers, good news to you I'll tell, of how the good old union has come in here to dwell. Tell me, which side are you on?